मयंक, आर यू देयर?
यस मैम,
ओके ओके, सो यू आर देयर, सो प्लीज टेक केयर ऑफ ऑल दीज थिंग्स विद मिस्टर रायकर, बिकॉज नाउ आई विल नॉट बी फोकसिंग ऑन ऑल द गेस्ट, सो प्लीज फोकस ऑन पार्टिसिपेंट्स. ओके
यस मैम.
हेलो. हाँ जी सनी जी. हाँ जी ओके पार्टिसिपेंट्स, प्लीज आई हैव एन अनाउंसमेंट फॉर यू. प्लीज डू नॉट एंटर विद द साइंस एंड हैशटैग्स. प्लीज डू नॉट एंटर. सम ऑफ यू आर एंटरिंग विद द साइंस ओनली. प्लीज लॉग आउट, री एंटर विद योर फुल नेम. राइट योर फुल नेम्स, अदरवाइज विल हैव टू रिमूव यू बिकॉज ऑफ द सिक्योरिटी रीजन्स. वी कैन नॉट लेट एनी पर्सन एंटर विद साइंस ओनली. इवन प्लीज डू नॉट एंटर विद योर डिवाइस नेम. Enter with your name. Whoever is entering with their device or with their or with some sign. So please log out and please re-enter with your full names. Do not enter with signs, abstract signs and device names, because then it becomes difficult for us to see that whosoever is joining the meeting. Please do so. Thank you for your cooperation.
Participants, you can just click on your names. You can find your names in the participant list. You can just right click on the those name and you can rename yourself. आप आपके नाम को, अगर आपका नाम अप्रोप्रिएट नहीं है तो आप आपके नाम पे जो पार्टिसिपेंट लिस्ट में आपको मिल जाएगा वहां पे राइट क्लिक करके आपके नाम को आप रीनेम कर सकते हैं.
I want to ask principal sir, sir, should we start? Because it's already 3 o'clock.
Yes, madam. Okay, please start, ma'am.
Okay, thank you, sir. So now we are formally starting. I welcome Dr. M. Ratnashree on this platform. We are entering into the day two of this Eduthon 2020, which is hosted by Government Mother Science PG College Ujjain on this virtual platform, Zoom platform, which is live streaming on YouTube also. We welcome you, madam. This Eduthon 2020 we are organizing in the light of new education policy, where we are talking about the education policy or the education system in India from present to future, as our Prime Minister said. We are discussing all these things. And to discuss one of the parameters, to discuss a very important thing, we have with us Dr. N. Ratnashree. Dr. N. Ratnashree is Director, Nehru Planetarium, Nehru Memorial Museum and Library. She has worked for PhD in Astrophysics at the Tata Institute of Fundamental Research, Mumbai. Postdoctoral work in radio astronomy at University of Vermont, USA, and Raman Research Institute, Bangalore. Madam is a known astro. I can say that she is a very famous female in the astronomy and area and astrophysics area. We look up to her for the inspiration which we can derive from the great personalities like her. We welcome you, Madam, on this platform. Today we have the participants pan India. Some of us are, some of these participants are faculty, some are senior faculty, fresh faculty in the field of education, some are research scholars and students too, and participants are just entering. So let them enter. I welcome you participants also in this second day of Edutron 2020, when Dr. Ratnashree will be speaking to you. And she she will be speaking on inspiration from astronomy in the works of Kalidas of Ujjaini, a very pertinent topic when she's speaking on the platform hosted by a college at Ujjain. Definitely Kalidas becomes very important. So ma'am, I welcome you once again with folded hands, and now I'll request principal of the college to please come forward and welcome her for me. Welcome, sir. Sir, unmute kar lijiye apne ko.
Thank you, Dr. Kalpana Singh. It's really a matter of great pleasure that we have an astrophysicist like Dr. Ratnashree with us. Of course, Dr. Ratnashree is not new for Ujjain. She and her presence can be felt in Ujjain in the form of planetarium here in Ujjain, because she has always been there in advising and in not only in advising, rather in the implementation of projects run by MP Council of Science and Technology here in Ujjain. Normally we used to read her in newspapers, but it is really, I must say that the dream has come true, that she is in our college, she is on a virtual platform of our college, and we are hosting her. So this is really a matter of great pleasure. Dr. Ratnashree, I must thank you for giving our valuable time. And the topic which you have chosen is really, it really implies what new education policy says, that you can switch to anything of your own interest. Kalidas is, for a scientist, Kalidas, he may feel that, oh, this is of what should I do with this man? But your talk today will enlighten any person from science stream that, no, you can't, you cannot neglect literature, you cannot neglect history of Indian literature, you cannot neglect great works done by Indian poet or what we have in our heritage. All that comes with science, that has a scientific background that you are going to show us. So when we come forward with science, we must not forget that how old traditions we have of the science. Ujjain being the most ancient city in the country, Puranas and Vedas. So your enlightenment today will definitely give a new light to all of us, all the participants and all the faculty members, everyone who is listening to us, or all those who will be viewing even after your presentation on YouTube. They will be finding that it was a wonderful day. I welcome you once again, ma'am, and wish to see you here in Ujjain, not on the virtual platform, but in person. We'll be very happy if we can see you, as you come to Ujjain many times. And next time, when the things become normal and under new normal conditions, we'll be very happy if you can come to our college and can guide us and bless us. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. And now, please be ready for the mesmerizing lecture or the mesmerizing presentation which we are going to have from Dr. Ratnashree. Welcome, ma'am. The platform is all yours. Welcome.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you, Principal sir. Thank you, Dr. Kalpana and the team from Government Madhava College, Ujjain. When you asked me to give a talk for this session, current session, I wanted to talk about the inspiration from astronomical phenomenon in the works of Kalidasa. This being the field of astronomy being something very close to me, Kalidasa being something so representative of your land, Ujjain, and the fact also that through such interdisciplinary celebrations, and in particular, I am looking at interdisciplinary aspects where astronomy has a footprint, has a way of reaching to a large number of people and drawing them in to get interested in astronomy. And so that is one of the reasons why I thought that this would end in many cases, like for current instance, for instance, and also so many creative spirits who have been inspired. If we look back in time at the times when the skies were clear, there was no light pollution and there was no disturbance from so many other aspects of modern life, the night skies provided an inspiring kind of a stage wherein just the movement of celestial objects provided so much of inspiration, and it needed somebody with a little bit of a kind of someone who looks at something and tries to see what are the patterns there and gleans them, and all of that gleaning which has been done percolates into their own creative spirit. So there have been such creative spirits throughout the millennia who have been inspired by astronomy, and we may see a few of parallels here, like for instance the works of Shakespeare have astronomical references throughout, and in fact I'm going to touch upon one particular reference where it's the same thing which has been fleshed out by Shakespeare and by Kalidasa, one particular simple aspect. And there are many creative spirits. In fact, in our country, there is one name which nobody does not know. And I don't mean Kalidasa. A little more modern times, there is one person. And you would all be surprised when I tell you how deeply he was interested in astronomy. And that is Mahatma Gandhi. Gandhiji, one associates him with looking into the problems of the nation and finding solutions for them and getting totally involved in that. However, he had many, many other interests which people do know. One of them, and particularly for a brief period which came up a lot, was astronomy. So he used to write to children asking them to look up sky maps and get to know the night sky. I'm just mentioning this because while I'm speaking about the beautiful references which Kalidasa's work have on the phenomenon of astronomy, I would just like to also talk to some of you, maybe young students who, or any of you who have some interest in astronomy and maybe have not yet had time to look it up. That's what Gandhiji also said, that he was always interested, but there were 2 years in which, when he was in the Yerawada Mandir, when he had a little time to look up the night sky and learn it. So I would like to just, along with talking about some of the references in Kalidasa's work, I would also like to give a little help to anyone who may be interested to know how to befriend the sky. So I will do that along the way. So now I also want to mention that I'm not an expert either in literature or in Sanskrit or Kalidasa, none of this. My expertise lies in the field of astronomy, and these days my expertise lies in bringing astronomy to people. So you please have to bear with me about that. So the thing is that many of the literary tools utilized by Kalidasa, they show an extreme sensibility towards human interaction. This is just my kind of layperson's understanding of the works of Kalidasa. So it shows an extreme sensibility towards human interactions and the sanctity of nature. So in a way, interplay of these, and they interplay enormously, human interactions and human emotions along with nature. Now, in that many a time, there are a lot of astronomical references also scattered throughout his works. And perhaps linguistic scholars may not have found these references to be as finely drawn as his nature, simple basic nature references perhaps. And somehow it seems to be that this thing, this aspect, facet of Kalidasa's, that he had a deep interest in astronomy, which can be seen from his works in literature, is not such a well-known phenomenon, well-known aspect. Okay, but to someone who has keen interest in astronomy, even a little bit of perusal of Kalidasa's works throws up aspects of astronomy, which immediately one thinks that, oh, he has had a little deep look at these aspects of astronomy. And for those of you who may be amateur astronomers or astronomers, you'd realize some of the things I have listed here in this slide, some of the kind of astronomical phenomenon he has referred to: eclipses, conjunctions when two celestial objects appear together in the sky, occultations when one celestial object seems to go behind one. So there are instances when a background star maybe or a planet appears to go behind the moon. So such events, which those of you who are into astronomy would know that these are common occurrences which happen. But unless one is into this, into observations in astronomy, one would not have noticed this. Eclipses, yes, and solar eclipse, total solar eclipse happens around one. Even somebody who is totally not at all interested in astronomy would have to, at the time of totality, would get an inkling. But for the rest, one needs a little careful observation to be able to, and we'll see actually sometimes the kind of observations needed are really quite advanced views of the sky. We'll see that. And there is, I mean, somewhat this is something of a speculation of mine, that one reference, astronomical reference, actually it refers to there was an eclipse of moon taking place, and as the moon come out of eclipse, there was probably a star which was either in close conjunction, the star Rohini nakshatra or Aldebaran, either close to the moon or even may have slipped behind the moon, which does happen many a time. And even the light pollution created in the night sky by the presence of the moon, even this is referred. And of course, the pole star, which remains stationary in the northern sky. And this is again speculation, but perhaps the movement of a comet across the sky. See, what happens is that when we have the night sky, we have all the stars and their motions are a little more, little less complex in a way than the movements that we see in the sky of the solar system objects. They have additional motions because they are closer to us, they are going around the sun, so these movements can be discerned. So a comet in the solar system, when we view it, actually with respect to the background sky, it keeps changing its positions. And Kumar Sambhavam, there is a reference which is generally thought to mean that a view of a comet in the sky was seen as it moved across the sky. And there are many more. In fact, we should have spent a whole day or a few days just looking up the astronomical references in Kalidasa, and it will be really, really fruitful. Okay. So now when we have... there is one other motion, one other reference, which actually implies that they may have had been quite rigorous observation. Now, this is in Malvika Agnimitra. Let me just mention what is in this reference, and I will try to show you also in the night sky how this would have to be observed. So that this, just using this one reference, I will try to place in perspective how carefully Kalidasa must have had observed the skies in order for him to have had used such a reference. So this is in Malvika Agnimitram, and so the specific reference comes a little later. So I'll come to that. I'll come to this just in a little while. I just wanted to give a little more overall view of it. So he was a poet, right? Not an astronomer, but he would definitely qualify as an amateur astronomer based on some of these references. And of course, his works are replete with hauntingly beautiful portraits of atmospheric phenomenon, and these are perhaps also literary wise very beautiful. And sometimes when the astronomical references come, we will see how they actually get set. Usually kind of a simile, there would be a simile which refers to what is happening in the sky and what is happening in the story. So let me maybe skip some of these slides because I wanted to come to the Malvika Agnimitram slide. Maybe I will come back to this. And yes, I have come to this example, Mars in retrograde. So there is, when we come to the planets, so what happens is that, or any solar system object, what happens is that, we take the equator and throw it up into the sky. We see this in the sky, the celestial equator. We take the path of the sun, annual apparent path of the sun, and that is called ecliptic. That makes another circle in the sky. And the sun is visible only along this ecliptic in the sky, only along this ecliptic. And the solar system objects will be scattered just around the ecliptic. They are not seen anywhere else. And on this ecliptic, in general, what is called prograde motion. So time to time, I'll just show it to you with the help of a software, just in a while. The planets appear to move with respect to the background objects, west to east. And then there is a time when they sometimes start moving east to west with respect to background objects, and then back again west to east. Prograde, retrograde, prograde. So they make a loop in the sky. So this particular movement of Mars is referred. It's referred in many literature creative efforts. Shakespeare in All's Well That Ends Well. Saturn in opposition to Mars in retrograde is mentioned by Walter Scott, Sir Walter Scott, and Kenilworth. And so this is the reference in Shakespeare, where Helena and Perules, they're having a conversation, and she says that you must have been born under, this is of course a little bit of an astrological connection too, but says born under Mars, and when he was retrograde, because she is trying to needle him in some sense. But let's leave that, and let's come to the Kalidas reference. Kalidas in Malvika Agnimitra refers to the retrograde motion of the Mars, how? At the end of the third act of this play. King Agnimitra is talking to his wife Iravati and has some misunderstandings with her and over his love for Malvika. And the queen sweeps away from him after some arguments. And so she walks away in anger. And Agnimitra's friend Gautama, he advises him. He advises the king. And please again, forgive me, I'm talking in English. I mean, I'm translating everything into English here because that is how I have put them all together. And I'm sure that a lot of the beauty is lost in translation. But even so, we can get a wealth of feel for Kalidasa's interest in astronomy. So Gautama says, let us make haste and move away from this place before she may retrace her steps, like the planet Mars in retrograde, and return to a given Rashi. So Mars is in one location and it has moved to some place and then making a loop has come back to the same location. So this actually happens in the sky. We'll see through the software. And Gautama is kind of making a simile with this, that Queen Iravati may go away but then come back again. And here I think they are perhaps intending to meet Malvika and so all of this. So that is what is there. Now, it may be a little bit of a forced simile. I don't know. I'm not a literature expert. So it may be because some of these astronomical references I have not really found that much in the context of literary criticism. And so perhaps that is what it is. But the fact that he has observed a complicated phenomenon of this kind, let me just take you to the astronomical software. And here I have this software. And once again, let me mention how Gandhiji advised all of us to look up such sky maps. Here, the sky is in this circle. And that is the sky map. So if we have the night time, for instance, you would see the stars and constellations in such a map. And so this is the map. Now I want to actually go to the month. Maybe I'll start with this month. And I need also to do one thing just so that, you know, as I'm running this software, I probably should remove this, the atmosphere so that, and I should also remove the ground so that the sky is always visible to us. And this is the sky. And so it's filled with stars. What I want to do, what do I want to do? I want to locate the object Mars. So that's Mars. Since I've removed ground and atmosphere, it's going to be visible to us all the time. Let me again locate Mars. And I want to, yeah, I need to do one more thing. I need to make sure that as Mars moves, we have a kind of a trail of its movement. Okay, so with this, I think probably I can talk about what I wanted to talk. Let me just make sure I get Mars again in this. Okay, so this is the planet Mars, and we have the stars and the sun and the moon. All of these are visible simply because artificially, using this simulated software, I have removed the atmosphere, I have removed the ground, and so on. So that's why we are seeing everything together. Now, this object, this is at a specific time. We see here the year, month, date, and this is the time, hours, minutes, seconds. What I'm going to do now is move the time forward, and you will see. Please just take a note of this. Here we have all the stars, and this is the planet Mars. And with time, you will see that Mars makes a kind of, let's see, makes a kind of a path, you can see. What we are trying to do is keep the old location of Mars so that we are making a kind of a path in this. So we can see that it is moving with respect to, if I stop the movement, see, when we look at these stars and we look at this group of stars again the next day, several months later, the relative positions of these stars will remain the same, but not so with Mars. And not so with many other solar system objects. They appear to change with respect to this background. So this was needed to be observed. And you observe Mars regularly over a period of time. And then it is having this prograde motion. Prograde, I think now probably it may be coming close to when it starts going retrograde. Yeah, you can see it has started moving in the other direction. And then again, it will start going prograde. So this... Now, in software, it is easy to see. In real sky, not so easy. So in software, I can actually demonstrate the whole thing. This is what Mars did in the sky. If you know these stars, so it was near this star at some time, this star at other times, and so on. If you are an expert in observing the skies, you would know all this. And if you're an expert, of course, you may still say that it's not so difficult to notice that Mars is going retrograde, prograde. But in general, it is not something which is a very simple observation. And this observation he must have had done perhaps many times for it to have had come about so very naturally in his So this was the reference, right? Where Gautama is saying, let's make haste and move away from this place before she retraces her steps and come like planet Mars. So although this, I've been talking a lot about just this one particular reference, but this shows the kind of keen observations he must have been used to. It's not even that he has seen something and then today he has seen something. And so tomorrow while writing, he got inspired by that. And not that. This is something he has done continuously. He's very, very comfortable with it. And while trying to think up a simile, so he thought, like, this is an interesting simile which can be put. So that is something which definitely tells us that he was a keen astronomer. He was observing this. Now, there have been many attempts. Yes. So he was like this. This kind of was that he was a major astronomer. We're looking at distance. Now there have been some efforts by his interest with us has shown trying to find out the age. thing.
Switch off your video. Voice issues are there. Ma'am, video switch off kar de. Please, there are certain voice issues. Ma'am, can you hear me? Mr. Raikwal, you please step in and suggest what to do.
If author has to
ma'am, I have unmuted. I have muted ma'am's camera, so I think it will be better right now.
But
all such phenomenon, and of course the retrograde motion of Mars, which I tried to show.
I think the screen share has also been stopped. Ma'am, are you listening? Ratnashri, ma'am, your screen is not visible, madam.
रत्नाश्री मैम, आप आपका जो वीडियो है वो उसे एक्टिवेट ना करें. वीडियो एक्टिवेशन के कारण जो है आपको ज्यादा बैंडविड्थ कंज्यूम हो रहा है, इसलिए आपकी वॉइस डिस्टॉर्ट हो रही है.
I think Madam cannot hear us. Can she hear us?
Ma'am, her speaker is open and I think she can hear us.
Okay. But she is not audible. We cannot hear us. We cannot hear her audio.
Hello, Ratnashri ma'am, am I audible to you? Hello. Ma'am, you're not audible to us. We can hear you. We can't hear your voice, ma'am. Ma'am, I will suggest that just you disconnect this and rejoin this meeting again. So the session, so the settings will get from the beginning, it will be settled out.
Has she entered? No.
Hello. Ma'am, she hasn't joined it yet.
Yeah, she's joining. Please admit her, she's joining.
Yes, am I audible now?
Yes, ma'am, audible, ma'am.
Shall I restart my screen share?
Yes, ma'am.
I apologize for that. Okay. Over the internet, these issues do keep coming. Sorry about that.
Yeah.
And so, shall I keep my video off now for better bandwidth?
What do you suggest?
Yes, ma'am. Please keep your video off. It will provide you a better bandwidth, ma'am.
Yes. So I was, my apologies to everyone. There are some glitches keep happening. We are going to have this long distance. the interactions and talking about the possibility of you
Hello, ma'am. Your voice is breaking, ma'am.
So,
no, ma'am, still not audible, ma'am. ठीक है मैं बोल हेलो हेलो रत्नाश्री मैम यू आर स्टिल नॉट ऑडिबल
Ma'am, can we do one thing? If we just stop screen, we can hear you otherwise also, ma'am. You can just speak.
Ma'am, she has already stopped the screen sharing.
No, she has stopped screen sharing, but I cannot hear still. I still cannot hear her voice.
Actually, ma'am, I also can't hear.
Let me call her.
Ratnashi, ma'am, is your software which we are demonstrating is active also right now? So it might be taking the bandwidth. So I will suggest ki if you just close that, then it will be you will get a better bandwidth.
Participants, there is just a technical glitch. Ratnashri, madam, she has switched off her software and she is trying to re-enter again and she will be speaking again. So kindly bear with us for 5 minutes. This is a technical problem. She's there at Delhi and there are some bandwidth issues. So please bear it with us for some time. She's again entering. Mr. Administrator, can you hear me?
Yes, Sunny,
can what about Madam Ratnashree? She's not here.
No, ma'am. She has left the meeting and still she hasn't joined me.
She said she's trying to reboot her system.
Actually, what has happened? The software which she was demonstrating now, that has consumed a lot of RAM, and that's why it is Zoom is also not responding. That might be an issue. So that's why she had to just reboot the system, and then it will be a perfect thing.
Okay, so let us see.
She has joined in or not. Ma'am, I can see her in the meeting list. I will just ask to unmute. She is still in the meeting list. She hasn't.
But she's not. She said she is trying to reboot. Now I think she has left the meeting.
Hello.
Hanji sir.
Madam, please ring her and ask her if she can join or if she's trying.
Sir, she's trying to reboot her. Okay. I just called. She said, I'm trying to reboot myself.
While you keep on addressing the participants, please speak something like not exactly about this program. Something else also we can talk about education policy or something. If she joins.
I think she might be joining within, 4 to 5 minutes. Basically, all this happened because of that software. Because that was, quite... she was running a quite heavy software and it consumed a lot of bandwidth. That is why it happened. So she is trying and she might be entering within some period. So participants, as you see that, she were just explaining about that how the astronomical phenomena, they were referred by, not only by Kalidasa, but also she was mentioning to Shakespeare and all, कि कैसे वो वहां से लेकर शेक्सपियर से लेकर कालिदास तक की जो वो बात कर रही थी कि किस प्रकार से एंड वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट थिंग विच आई कुड लर्न फ्रॉम हर वाज दैट शी वाज टॉकिंग अबाउट परजर्वेंस व्हेन शी वाज टॉकिंग अबाउट दैट मार्स चेंजेस इट्स पाथ एट दैट टाइम द मार्स चेंजेस इट्स पाथ विद इन अ सर्टेन अमाउंट ऑफ टाइम सो इट इज नॉट अ डेज फिनोमेना सो इफ यू जस्ट ऑब्जर्व मार्स चेंजिंग इट्स पाथ सो दैट मीन्स You have to observe Mars for a, I can say for a long period of time, and then it requires really a great amount of effort and the perseverance too that you keep on doing. And I think this is the phenomena where science comes, and this is the phenomena from where science starts. That when you keep on doing certain things, then ultimately you leads to a point from where you can start researching, from you where you can start doing something. Hypothesis is built like that way. I think madam is again joining. Ratnashri madam is joining. So within no time she will again be with us. So till then we can have a takeaway lesson that if we are into science, if we are doing science, serious science, practicing science, in that condition we have to follow this practice with very genuine practice of perseverance, where we must keep going, where we must keep on doing something. Yes sir,
I want to say something,
ma'am. Yes sir.
Dear participants, I want to ask if any of you is from Sanskrit background, or if anyone who is a fellow of Sanskrit and yes. has learnt about Kalidas
Yes,
please raise your hand.
Yes, that would be wonderful actually to do a collaboration with literature scholars, and because there are a number of these references, I only mentioned in fact just one in detail. Am I interrupting, sir? You are asking no, please, participants.
Ma'am. No, ma'am, we were just waiting for you. Please go ahead, ma'am.
I really apologize. And my system is still not too. Yes, I will try and now share my screen again. Sir, but what you were saying about asking participants who have this literature and Sanskrit expertise and possible collaboration with them would be a very wonderful thing, because there are a number of these, and then I mean I could bring in the astronomy expertise and. The literature expertise is needed.
Right, ma'am. That is what I was thinking. But we'll do with it later on, and we'll be very happy if you can start with your presentation again. And
yes. I'm just trying to do
it. It is very interesting thing that we are listening today.
Thank you. So I will. I think I have shared my presentation now. Yeah, I have shared my presentation. So my apologies to everyone for that glitch which happened, but I was talking of a number of quite rigorous astronomical observations which have percolated into the works of Kalidasa. So there are a number of eclipses, conjunctions would refer to in the sky a close appearance of certain celestial objects. Now star positions would not change. Of course they do change throughout the year, but the relative positions do not change, but the relative positions between the planets and the stars does change. So several planets, maybe I mean a planet can appear close to a moon, a planet can appear close to another planet, a planet can appear close to a star, moon can appear close to a star. These are conjunctions. In fact, these are the kind of phenomenon which do take place quite frequently. And though just ask yourself, all of you, these kind of phenomena have been happening now every month. There would have been something or other interesting in this, but how many of us are aware of these phenomena? We are not, unless we are actually amateur astronomers, then of course we are usually aware of all of these, and even at that, many a time we miss observing many of these. And then an occultation, as I was mentioning, lunar eclipse, and as I was also mentioning in the beginning, light pollution. Let me just see if some of these specific references I can share with you. And in fact, what my presentation that way is still very incomplete. There are hundreds of such references, and I've just picked up a few. There seems to be some problem still. Okay, so yeah. So we already talked of the Malvika Mitra, Agni Mitra, Mars retrograde. And so let me move on. And let's come to Shakuntalam, Abhigyan Shakuntalam. And this is again, I was going through, of course, a translated version of it. I have been looking at it in Hindi and in English. I'm not a Sanskrit. I find that, again, translations, different people translate it slightly differently. Here, for instance, is a translation. This happens just at the time after Dushyant has found the ring, and he comes across his son, and the son takes him to Shakuntala. And so Shakuntala just gets to know that Dushyant has recognized her again. And that is when this particular couplet is there. Now, different people have translated it differently when I look at it in English or Hindi. So as Principal Sir was mentioning, that if we work together from the original Sanskrit and try to see the different aspects which can be drawn out, it would be a wonderful possibility. Now, here is an author writer's translation of that from Act 4, just at that time. And Shakuntala knows that Dushyant has recognized him. So he translates it like this. Eclipse flees far. Eclipse has moved away. Light follows soon. And the loving star draws to the moon. This is what Arthur Rider's translation. And here we have Chintamani Ramachandra Devdar's translation. By the kindness of heaven, O lovely faced one, you stand again before me. The darkness of whose delusion, darkness of the delusion of Dushyant has been dispelled. And he is now able to recollect. And then this is the interesting part. Devdarji's translation says that the star Rohini at the end of an eclipse rejoins her beloved moon. So this is where I wanted to pause and discuss something with all of you. Now, why did we mention Rohini? Rohini is one of the nakshatras, the 27 or 28 nakshatras. Moon coming close to one of these, each of these nakshatra, it moves closer to each of these nakshatra. That is the day-to-day motion, the tithi, changes of the moon. So amongst these, there are some nakshatras which, if the moon is close to on the day of the full moon, they actually give rise to the name of the month. So there is that. And some of these nakshatras, actually, if they are closer to the ecliptic in the sky, where the moon's path can come, so then moon actually comes close to these nakshatras time to time. I'm not going to now risk showing my software and showing, otherwise I could have shown all this phenomenon. Maybe towards the end when we have discussions, I will do that. But let me just put it orally to you. So there is this star Rohini or Aldebaran. It is in the constellation of Taurus, the bull. It's a zodiacal constellation. So the zodiacal constellations are 12 constellations which are showing the path, annual path of the sun. And the nakshatras are showing the monthly movement and throughout the year, the movement of the moon. So the Rohini is one such nakshatra. And we also have mythological one context where moon is thought to be spending a lot of time near with Rohini rather than with other wives of his, and he gets cursed. And that is how this is, of course, a literary way of looking at it. And that's how the phases of the moon have started. So all in all, Rohini and moon have been present both in the sky a lot, close together, and also in literary context. And so here, the fact that is Rohini actually mentioned specifically as Rohini, or is it mentioned as a special star in the original? And this is where I would like to ask for help from Sanskrit scholars. And here is one translation from a Sanskrit scholar who has mentioned the star Rohini and says that Rohini at the end of an eclipse rejoins her beloved moon. Now, this line, I want to just pause at this line. And as an astronomer, I want to think what made him write it like this. Why did he mention, he mentions eclipse. And so eclipse, and he mentions moon. at the end of eclipse, he mentions a star. So this must be a lunar eclipse. So Shakuntala as the moon, maybe beautiful moon, or as Rohini joining the moon. Moon is under eclipse. So perhaps that is referring to Dushyanta's not remembering Shakuntala. That is the eclipse. After the eclipse has ended, he remembers Shakuntala, and the star Rohini, which was far away from the moon, has moved towards the moon. Now, this is something which happens, as I was telling you, conjunction of Rohini to the moon keeps happening. But of course, it's not very frequent, but it can happen time to time. And there are also some things called repeated lunar occultations of a particular star. So repeated lunar occult, that means what? Every month, moon comes close to the star Rohini and may even occult it. So this happens, but again, there's a long period when this will not happen, and then this will happen again. So perhaps there was a period when Kalidasa saw this, that moon was occulting Rohini frequently. So his interest may have been drawn by that. But if we take this literally, does it mean that a lunar eclipse has ended, and after around that time, because moon's position in the sky is also moving because of the motion of the moon around the earth, so it has come closer to the star Rohini. Has this happened? Now, this is a very specific kind of astronomical phenomenon, and there would not be too many frequent events of this kind. So one could look up back to see whether there is such an event in that period. However, this kind of periodicity is not so easily mathematically possible. I mean, it is possible. It's just that it hasn't yet been looked at perhaps so far. So, but one could scan through events and try to find, was there a lunar eclipse when an event through, the kind of planetarium program and programmings, this could be looked at. But before that, you would want to be sure that Kalidasa, did he actually see such an event and was inspired by it and put it in Shakuntala? And to me, it seems like, otherwise, why would he bring all such thing in? Why would he bring such a thing in? Except that the motion of the moon during the time that it is in eclipse is only going to just faintly move it closer to the star. So within an hour, for instance, the star can go behind the moon and come from out of it. So that much, which is about half a degree in the sky. So in an hour, the movement of the moon closer to a star, if it is moving, could be about half a degree in the sky. And the eclipse, of course, takes place over a little longer time scale. So it is possible. And definitely he was a keen observer. So he may have had seen this. So that's really very, 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 very thrilling to think about and find out whether such a thing has happened. But before that, help from scholars to make sure what exactly is being mentioned here. Now, if we read the rest of the Abhijana Shakuntalam, mention of the sun and the moon, and like, let's say the sun is just rising. And I think I do have the reference somewhere. Yeah, here it is. This happens actually just after Shakuntala is lost in her thoughts about Dushyanta, and then the sage who has been ignored by her, Durvasa Muni, and he curses her. And after that event, just when the Kapila Muni is returned back to the ashram, the discussion is about the morning daylight. Morning twilight, just as the Kapil Muni is returning to the ashram. So it talks about moon behind the western mount. So a mountain in the western side, moon is sinking behind that, and the eastern sun is heralded by dawn. This is an English translation, of course. Again, as I said, please forgive me. I am not talking with from the original context, but we will pull them out. Now, this kind of a reference where the sun is just rising and moon is setting, this happens only at the full moon time. When it is the time of full moon, sun and moon are opposite to each other in the sky. And so that's when you will see that the moon is setting and the sun is rising. And this same context is there in Romeo Juliet, Shakespeare. Romeo is just somewhere lingering near the balcony where Juliet is. What is the light in the eastern direction is what is thinking about, and then he says that that's Juliet, and Juliet is the sun, and the moon is sinking, and the moon is kind of ashamed of itself, and therefore it is going out of sight, and all of that. So that is also a context where in the morning the sun is rising and the moon is just setting. So But here we have this and yes. Yes. So here once again, from the same, talks about the moon setting behind a lofty mountain. And so the fact that moon was very high up in the sky. Now, moon being very high up in the sky also has to do with, it may need not always be very high up in the sky. So because the position of the sun related to that, where we see the moon, and the moon itself as it is moving around in the ecliptic, it goes through something called lunar standstills, and there are times when moon can be seen very high up in the sky as it is at the maximum, or times when it need not be seen. So again, did he see all this and put it in? And yeah, here is another very beautiful depiction. Just this is of course not so much astronomy, but just inspiration from nature, where Dushyanta has put a string of lotus flowers around the neck of Shakuntala. And he's talking about how this lotus chain, maybe the moon, crescent moon, which is like a necklace, crescent moon. And he talks about how the crescent moon with the horns, you will see the crescent moon horns just as the moon is setting. So the horns, then he talks of maybe they have just stretched forward and encircled the neck of Shakuntala. So a beautiful way of describing this. And from a simple phenomenon of observing the setting of a crescent moon. So that's another context. Now Shakuntala starts right in the beginning. We have in fact equation with scientific temper of the motion of the sun and the moon in the sky. So this is the benediction upon the audience, just prologue of Shakuntala. And sun and the moon are dividers of time. So which is what of course has been used for millennia, the movement of the sun and the moon in the sky has been used. And in India in particular, we have the lunisolar calendar, where the months like the Chaitra Mas, Kartika Mas, all these different months come about from the fact that moon, full moon, if it is close to the star grouping Kritika, then that month is Kartika Mas. If it is close to the star Chitra, that month is Chaitra Mas. Close to the star Jyeshtha, full moon, that is the Jyeshtha Mas, and so on. But the fact that it is a lunisolar calendar is actually using both the moon and the sun in timekeeping, in the calendrical timekeeping, because full moon means moon is opposite to the sun. That immediately determines the position of the sun. If the position of the moon is determined in the sky, the position of the sun is also determined from the fact that it is full moon. So that is how, in fact, our calendar is lunisolar. So it kind of moves through the solar calendar, moves a little back and forth. That's how you'll see that our dates of festivals move a little back and forth of the solar calendar. So all of this, just this one line, once again, it would be wonderful to work together, look at the original context in Sanskrit and from some of the scholars. That is, this is precisely the reason why I wanted to talk about this to an audience from Ujjain. And so it is my humble request from all of you that if we could work together, looking back into the original Sanskrit, we will find a number of such references. But this particular one, I was stuck by it, because here he's talking about how moon and sun are dividing the time. And this is a very, very scientific way of looking at the beautiful motions of sun and moon in the sky. And of course, if you go to Ritusamharam, we have this, since this is dealing with the seasons, and the seasons are determined by the earth's motion around the sun. And again, in those different times, the dates, etc., the calendar is determined by the sun and the moon as well. And so these are just discussions about how these are the view of these. Here is what I was mentioning about how Kalidas has just hinted about the fact that when the moon is there in the sky, it actually creates light pollution and hides the stars. So this is what it is talking about, that the moon, when it is very bright, its beauty is there, but the stars have become quite faint in that presence of the bright full moon. So this is in Ritusamharam, and this is a reference to it. And so from all of this, we can in fact conclude that In fact, I have several more references. I will try and pull them out now because of my moving back and forth in my presentation. I may have missed a few. So, but once again, I just wanted to mention this, that if you look through any of these works, and when the discussion comes about, let's say, simple fact of either the sun being there in the sky or the moon being there in the sky, a sunset or a moonset or a moonrise, or the presence of stars in the sky. In fact, there is somewhere, there is a mention of the star Canopus or Agastya. And in this context, this is in Raghuvansham, and this happens where this is just as Ram is growing up. So in that context, I don't know whether I have put it in this presentation, but I do have it somewhere else saved. So what happens in that is that in that Raghuvansham example, there is a talk of moving through the geography of the Indian subcontinent and also moving through time in months. So, which is probably natural in that context. I think I don't have that reference here, but I'll try to bring that out in a little while. I just don't want to disturb anything in the system. So now, the thing is that in this, there is a talk of going through the geography of the Indian subcontinent, and there's a talk of going through the seasons, the time. Months are changing. And there is a talk about how sun in the southern skies, so the southern skies is referring one to going to the south, and it is also referring to the Dakshinayan motion of the sun. Sun moves southwards in winter, so you will see due south, a little due south in the sky. And he specifically mentions how the heat from the sun is less at this instant, the southern presence of the sun. So the Dakshinayan movement of the sun and the coming of the winter. So this is very clearly talked about here in this context. And in Raghuvansham itself, there is one other reference. No, whether I put it here. Let me just see if I have that. Okay, I don't have that. But in Raghuvansham, there is a reference to five planets conjunction. Now, five planets conjunction means that in the sky, let's say in a fistful of sky, Muttibar Asman, suppose we were to find the bright planets, Mercury, Venus, these are closer to the sun and more difficult to see far away. I mean, they can never be seen far away from the sun. But if you want to have all the five, then we will have to look either towards the western skies in the evening or towards the eastern skies in the morning. So Mercury, Venus, bright enough, they would be Jupiter, Mercury, Venus would be very bright. And then Mars, reasonably bright. Jupiter, Saturn. These five planets, they would definitely be brighter than many a faint star in the sky. So if these five planets come in a fistful of sky, it would be really an amazing sight. A fistful of sky would mean about 10 degrees within a 10 degree radius in the sky. If all five planets, but this would have to be somewhere close to the sun, because Mercury is seen only when it is, I mean, too close to the sun. Such an event is relatively rare. There is supposed to have been one such planetary conjunction, even mathematically calculated. It permeates many of the historical astronomical works. 5102 BC, I think, that is around the time. So there was such a, and it is through this mention of such a five-planet conjunction in literary works that this has been kind of inferred, mentioning, this is mentioned in context of Ramayana. So Kalidas taking up a five-planet conjunction is not something which we could use to say that it was during Kalidas's time. But he may have had just looked up this reference in Ramayana versions which were available in his time, and known about this five-planet conjunction. And of course, it finds a place in Raghuvansham. And there is even a mention of measuring the movement of, there is somewhere, and this is again the English translation I've come across, which talks about a sun stick, which would be something like a gnomon, which is like a vertical stick planted on the ground, would show the shadow movement can actually be used for finding out the time. So there is such a mention in one of the references. So this today's session was just to give an kind of a broad glimpse that there are such very specific. Let me just go back to the original reference I gave. Yes. So light pollution of the moon they have talked about, and somewhere there is also, yes, there are good number of references to the direction north and the unchanging star there. And I was mentioning that in Kumar Sambhavam description about something which is seen. Well, this is about the process of the birth of Kumara, and it talks of a kind of, I mean, it is inferred in context by those who want to see astronomy in the works of Kalidasa, is inferred in context as a fuzzy object seen in the sky near the star grouping Kritika, and it has moved northwards. So all of this comes from the Kumar Sambhavam references. So that is a comet which is there. And I was mentioning that the star Canopus, that is also mentioned in Raghuvansham, where I was talking about moving southwards. And now Canopus is a star which is seen only from more better from the southern latitudes in India. And it is connected to the sage Agastya. And the lore talks of how Agastya, when he moved southwards, he asked the mountain to lower Vindhyas, and then he stayed south. So the star Agastya, which is seen more southern latitudes, is kind of connected with Agastya, and that is the star Canopus. And so in this southward wandering, Kalidasa also mentions the star Canopus. Now, if I may stop my screen share for a while, I would actually like to, if there are any questions or so, and also any responses to the request which Principal Sir had from the participants, if there is anything, any questions, etc. Meanwhile, I will try and get back some of the references I was mentioning. I stopped my screen share, I think. So if there are any questions which are there from the participants, if you could let me know. Are you able to hear me?
Yes, ma'am. We are able to hear you.
Yes. So I will go back to some of the other references I mentioned. So once again, ma'am, I do apologize that we lost some time in the talk in between when my connection went away. But now, are there any questions or any responses to what sir had asked?
Yeah, ma'am.
Because I'm very keen on such possibilities.
Okay. So now if we have such scholars within us, you can please raise your hands. We'll unmute you and you can ask questions, or you may respond what Principal Sir was saying. And ma'am is also requesting you for that. So please, if you have any questions, first of all, ask questions, raise your hands. And if you have anything to say about what Principal Sir was asking, then also you can raise your hands. Alternatively, as I told you, you can also... Yeah, ma'am, please go ahead.
No, are there any questions or any responses?
Ma'am, I can't see any raise hand options. Participants, you can please raise your hands, or alternatively, you can write us on the mail which I have provided you. Just if you are writing right now also, we have that mail box open and I'll read those questions for you, and ma'am will be happy to take those questions. Please respond. Let me see on YouTube also, ma'am, but I don't think so. YouTube chat has been disabled. Please raise your hand.
Yes. Yeah, meanwhile, I'm also looking up a few other references which I would like to share. But let's just see if there is any input from the participants. Yeah, there are several other mentions. Let me just continue speaking before any responses come. So in Raghuvansham, as I was mentioning, there are a number of references about the sun and the moon and the interconnections. So there are hints here which talks about how moon is getting the light from the sun. And also there is a mention of son, there's something, again, it's an English translation which talks about, I mean, Raghu Vansh, the Vansh of Raghu. And there's a mention of sun circled. This is, of course, referring perhaps to the halo around the kings and so on. On the other hand, I'm also wondering, and once again, one would need to look at the original Sanskrit for this, whether this may also be hinting a little bit about the atmospheric phenomenon of halos which are observed around the sun. So there are 22 degree and 45 or 44 degree halos observed around the sun, and those are atmospheric phenomenon. And these happen when there are crystals, ice crystals in the sky. Many of you may have seen. And so whether there is such an atmospheric phenomenon, and obviously Kalidasa must have seen many such phenomenon, because he was definitely someone who was very keenly interested in the atmospheric phenomenon in the daytime and the nighttime and so on. So there is perhaps a hint of a mention of a halo around the sun in one of the works. And in the Raghuvansham, once again, there is, I was talking about how the southern sun. So the English translation here, it says that the sun himself glows dim on southern shores. This is the one which I was mentioning, that southern shores. So which talking about the person who is observing it moving down south, also the sun itself moving down south. And all of this is happening when the discussion is about moving from autumn to winter. So this is, I mean, there is a lot of mention of the sun, sunrise from around autumn time and winter time and so on. Yes. And afterwards, in this, as we go on in Raghuvansham, it talks about how the king is now moving northwards along with the sun. So as the sun is moving northward, as the king is marching northwards after his trip down south, east and then south, marching northwards, the sun also is moving northwards at this time. So this is another very interesting reference from, the way the astronomy has inspired him.
Question from Dr. Toshi Wadia. Ma'am, at the time, there was no advanced lenses and telescopes. Computer softwares to calculate these astronomical activities. But still, Kalidasa had managed to observe them so nicely and also mentioned them in the literature. How it was possible and for him to do so?
Okay. See, the thing is that it is very true that there were no optical instruments, telescopes and so on at that time. But the eye could see, and eye has been seeing for millennia. So if we even look back into times of Rig Veda, Vedic literature, even Ramayana and Mahabharata literature is full of references to the sky, which the naked eye can see. The eye did see, and it was noted by people. And so there is a lot of astronomy which can be learned just by looking at the sky. And there were people who learned it. And so we do have back in the times of the Vedic literature and the times of the epics literature, we do have observational mentions of things which have happened in the sky. However, it may have had been followed soon after by whatever was seen in the sky. One can put a kind of a mathematical pattern to it. So that did happen. I mean, we do have, even before the times of greats like Aryabhatta, there was mathematics being pinned down to the naked eye observations of the sky. And of course, it was brought to a peak by the works of Aryabhatta. And so mathematical calculations, given that there is an object in the sky at some time, when the next event is going to take place, was there. It was very much there. In the times of Kalidasa, there was definitely, this is post Aryabhatta most probably, and there was definitely a good understanding of how to, let's say, calculate when an eclipse is going to take place and so on. So theoretically, there was a good progress at that time. Observationally, only naked eye observations. But these naked eye observations needed to be rigorous. And which is what we see in the works of Kalidasa. And he was not an astronomer. He was not an astronomer, but rigorous naked eye observations were carried out by him. So that's what we see. I hope that answered the question. Okay.
Even I have a question, ma'am.
Yes.
My question is this, ma'am. As a layman, I'm asking this question. How come this astrology and astronomy are two phenomena, ma'am? So how these are related, ma'am? Because even astrologers, they talk about a motion of Mars and Moon and all that. Then what is this, ma'am?
Yeah, basically, see, astronomy is a science. It is a science incorporating mathematics and observations, which can be a kind of verified astronomy. Now, astrology is not really a science, and it just uses some patterns which are given from the science of astronomy to talk of some other aspects which are not scientific, and which inferences are also not scientific. However, the basic positions of objects come from positional astronomy. So these are in fact separated as Ganit Jyotish. Ganit Jyotish is positional astronomy. That's science. Ganit Jyotish simply says that, okay, this is the position of sun and moon and planets and stars now. And using Ganit, I can tell you what will be the position in future. And I can even tell what was the position in past. So all of this is science and mathematics. This is Ganit Jyotish. This is valid. Falit Jyotish is the other aspect which people now refer to as astrology. Falit Jyotish says that if the sun was there, if the moon was there, if a person is born at such and such time, how the person's life is going to be. There is no scientific validity to this. And so this is just astrology uses astronomy to some extent. I personally believe it is a misuse. But I don't know that. But this is the demarcation between the two.
Thank you.
Yes. Yes. If there are further, if you wanted to know in terms of how astrology uses this, it is like, you know, positions of all of this can be calculated through astronomy, right? So then you can find out a particular date and say what was the positions of everything at that date. That much is the Ganit Jyotish. Okay. So, all right. And was there any other question? Because I just also wanted to mention one other eclipse reference in Raghuvansham. But if there's a question, I would like to take that up first.
Ma'am, I think you can go ahead with your thing. Then we can take the question then.
Yes. I'm just picking up some random references. But we can have the questions also along with it. That's fine. So there is a talk at some time, of course, it is talking about how Raghu, King Raghu's chariot has raised so much of dust and it has veiled the sun and it has darkened all the sky. Now, this may simply be like a huge dust which is raised, or on the other hand, he's again trying to draw a simile from an eclipse. So, but of course, such eclipse references are there aplenty in all of these works. So, that's it. And you're just trying to look through some of the other references.
Ma'am, yeah. There is an update question on that. Dr. Toshi has again asked that, ma'am, he mentioned about Mars, but Mars be visible by naked eyes?
Yes. There are 5 naked eye visible planets. So that is how I was mentioning, you know, that back in the year 5102 BC, there was 5 planets were seen together at one location. And there are mention of this in our epics. And so these 5 planets have been through millennia have been seen. Mercury, Venus, and Mars, Jupiter, Saturn. You don't need telescope to see this. Of course, telescope enhances your view. And people have been observing these planets from time immemorial and their motion, just like Kalidas observed how Mars, motion of the Mars, in the sky, it's a retrograde motion. People have been observing this all through. and of course, our knowledge of the solar system, works of Tycho Brahe, Kepler, etc., they depended heavily on observations of Mars. And those observations, initially, they were without telescopes as well. So if you want to know, currently, for instance, the planets Jupiter and Saturn are visible in the sky. And in the evening sky, Mars also a little later, Mars is there in the sky. If I can use my software, I will try it a little later. so that even if my system goes at that time, it will be all right. We can conclude. And I will try to show you what are the planets which are visible, what you can do to find out how you can see them in the sky. I would really like to take this opportunity to also give that help to those of you who want to befriend the skies. So we will do that in a while. So I hope that answers your question. That yeah, please.
There is another question by Professor Diva Mishra Ji. And Professor yes. Diva Mishra is a professor of chemistry. She's asking, can you, are these things work on Surya Siddhant written in Sanskrit? As it has been proven that many of the phenomena have been reported that time correctly, and does it correlate with the astronomy in present time?
See, in Siddhantic astronomy, that is from the earliest of astronomers in India, which could be, I mean, as early as the first century AD and so on, earliest of astronomers. So the works of their astronomical works would be put together in such Siddhantic texts. So, and then Surya Siddhanta, of course, is one of the most revered in these. And so these Siddhantic texts, what were they? They were basically putting together the concepts of what is observed in the sky, what are the motions of the sun, the moon, the planets, and the stars themselves. How do this change? The change in a day is relatively well understood, change over the year, and even in fact change over a longer period than that. So the Siddhantic texts actually talked about all of this. Now, in these, there was a kind of a mathematical framework in which they were put. There was one aspect, which is to do with the precision of Earth's axis of rotation, which wasn't fully understood at that time, and slowly, but it was put in as a correction called the Ayanamsa. So it is that correction which kind of slowly started decoupling from observations during the medieval periods. So we have very good calculated presence of these astronomical phenomena known in, let's say, from 1st to 10th century AD. But beyond that, because of the decoupling of the observation theory happened due to maybe one reason might be that the Ayanamsa corrections may have moved out. However, yes, there was good, very competent mathematical knowledge of what is happening in the skies. And there were also some observers, and there's one medieval astronomer, Parameshwara, whose emphasis was that no, the theory should agree with observations. This particular thing was not always there. I think in the Indian context, the beauty of theory and mathematics was felt much more. And though every Siddhantic text also has a chapter on instruments, but the instruments and observations did not come up so much as the theoretical frameworks. So, yes, we can actually now look back on these texts and we see that, yes, mathematically they were very significant, very competent. And observations-wise, there were attempts to make instruments and so on. But perhaps there was a period when the observations decoupled. All right. And then, of course, more in modern times, these calculations continue to date, right? So, to date, the Panchangas actually do the calendrical astronomy based on the same methods as the Siddhantic principles, except that because there has been a small decoupling from the actual observations over a period of time, we'll find that many of the Panchang calculations have then, every time they have to be made, because this is very complicated mathematical framework, and there are different methods of doing it. So the Ayanamsa correction was one way in which this could keep track of. So all of these are there. So I hope that answers my question. I probably went a little more technically than was actually was a part of the question itself. But I hope that answers the question.
Thank you for answering, ma'am. I hope it's clear to her now. Thank you, ma'am.
Yes. Okay. Was there any other?
Ma'am, there is another question.
Yes.
But that is related to, I think, Sastareka Vidyan and Jyotish, is writing. Which is better? It's a question by Dr. Manjeet Singh Saluja.
And I could not hear you very clearly.
Dr. Manjeet Singh Saluja is writing that Hastarekha Vigyan and Jyotish, which is better?
Actually, I think that question I cannot answer because I don't, astrology is not my field, and it's only astronomy, which is, as I was saying, Ganit Jyotish, which is purely to do with positions of objects in the sky. So I would not be able to answer that question. And so were there any others?
No,
I'm sorry about that.
You keep on with your deliberations, ma'am. Thank you, ma'am.
Yes. So, yeah, I was just trying to read through some of these the references which I have. Many of the references are simply to do with the sun and the moon and what happens when the sun is there in the sky down here on earth and what happens. Flowers, in particular, the reference to flowers, those which love sun and those which love moon. This comes up very, very frequently. All right. So, I come across one particular reference here, where they're talking about three nights a prince has camped and then leaves, and it talks about how as the moon deserts the sun. This is a simile. I think for Kalidas, simile is, I mean, it's like, isn't there a phrase also which talks about how a simile like Kalidas's? So one finds that most of the astronomical references come in the simile context. So he's talking about how a prince, when he's moved away, he's left a person, and the talk is about how moon deserts the sun. I would like to just mention a little bit here about how the position of the moon and the sun in the sky change through, let's say, a month, where the moon's phases are changing. So when you have new moon, the moon is very so close to the sun, you don't see the moon. Moon is there in the sky in the daytime, somewhere close to the sun. We don't see it. Of course, when moon comes exactly in front of the sun, we see the eclipse. But otherwise, Amavas, we don't see the moon. Then Prathama, Dvitiya, Tritiya. Maybe by the time of Tritiya, the moon has moved further enough away from the sun that we can start seeing it. As the sun set in the western sky, the Tritiya moon can be seen in the sun. Tritiya, then Chaturthi, moon. As the sun sets, we will see that the moon has moved a little further away. Then Panchami and so on. The tithis will keep changing. So as the tithis keep changing, you can actually see, if you see this very carefully, and I can actually demonstrate this with planetarium software very beautifully, that it's in front of you. How it's like the prince moving away, that's in front of you. Moon, step by step, is moving away from the sun. So although this is a very simple observation of phases of the moon and the distance of the moon from the sun at different phases, he must have seen this. Every month he would have seen it. And it's just that us modern beings are not so aware of this. So some of these are very simple observations, but so beautifully drawn into these literary references. So that is one. Okay. And I will try and find a few more references. And we can. You please also let me know, Doctor. How much time I have? I will try and put in a lot more of references as the time goes. But if there are some questions, I would like to answer those too. Because a lot of the references I'm coming across right now are not such references that wherein I can bring in astronomy. So that's why I'm just trying to go through those. Okay. And the Raghuvansham reference, which I was mentioning, where the chariot of the king is throwing up dust and hiding the sun. Now, the dust would hide the sun, but it talks about also how the entire sky is dark from that. That is the reason why I was wondering whether that reference is talking about an eclipse. Because what happens? If there is a cloud or there is a big dust cloud and it is showing, it is closing the sun, it will not get so dark. Unless, of course, there are some clouds which make it very, very dark. But he's talking of the chariot itself. And so that is the reason why this reference struck me as interesting. There's also a mention of how, this is again in Raghuvansham only, how the moon in the nighttime, the moon is so very bright. It is dominant in the sky, right? But as the dawn comes up, if the moon is still in the sky, how the brightness of the moon goes down. And so this is also referred to in one of the references in Raghuvansham. So some of these, as I was saying, are very, very simple references. But some of them are a little more complex, wherein a little more complicated and rigorous observations are implied, like in the retrograde motion of Mars. So that is, maybe I should stop here. And if there are further questions, and I would perhaps also like to take this up on a little more on a platform where perhaps we will not have this particular problem. And since I had some system problems, I am missing some of the references which I wanted to share with you. So if you'll give me time again, maybe in a different context, I will try and put to you some of these. And no, along while working with you in looking at these references in Sanskrit. So I think it would be very nice if we could have another such session where a scholar, Kalida scholar, is going to be here with us. And so we can actually discuss these references in the original Sanskrit and try to bring out. And I would like to give my astronomy inputs. Okay. And moon and sun alternate rising. Okay. So there are again some simple reference about how moon and sun alternately they are giving the radiance to the earth. Simple enough reference. It need not be. All right. Yes. Yeah, there is a talk about how during a full moon, when the sun sets, the moon rises, and when the moon sets, the sun rises. This is also there in Raghuvansham. And I'm missing some of the other references I wanted to share with you, but I hope to do that as we have discussions or in a further sessions. Okay. Yeah, there is definitely a clear mention of eclipse in Raghuvansham, where, again, I am reading the translation, black as cloud of night, a Rakshasa, Viradha named, stood up, opposing Rama's march, as Rahu's bulk obstructs the moon. So once again, a simile, it is talking about during the war, how a Rakshasa came and kind of eclipsed the view, opposing the march of Ram. And so here the simile is talking about Rahu obstructing the moon. Rahu, of course, obstructing the sun would create solar eclipse and obstructing the moon. So basically, this is, of course, the mathematical Rahu and Ketu, Aryabhata identified them with the mathematical nodes in the orbit of the moon. And when moon is on those mathematical node points, and if the sun and earth and moon are in line, we have eclipses. So if moon is in between sun and earth at such a time, we have solar eclipse. And if earth is in between the sun and the moon, we have the lunar eclipse. So all this was, to some extent, was put forward by Aryabhata. And given the interest that Kalidasa had, Kalidasa must have had, would have been well aware, perhaps, of the physically what exactly is happening in the context of. That is why, you know, like Rahu, which is kind of referred to as a demon, etc., has come in here. It is coming in the context of a Rakshasa, definitely. But however, many of these eclipse references which come in Kalidasa, give a feel that, yes, he had a good physical idea of this. Okay. And, oh my goodness, yes. I this is a reference I had not come across before, and it would be wonderful to discuss this with the original context. But there is a reference to how, oh my goodness, it's talking about ocean waves which are swollen by the moon. That's a hint of tides and moon being in some way having a hand to play in the tides, in the rise of ocean tides. Of course, even if the gravitational context wasn't understood fully, and who knows, perhaps it was, but the fact that the position of the moon, see, observationally itself, this would have been sufficient to know. The fact that the relative positions of the sun and the moon and the tides, how high they rise, will depend on the relative positionings between sun, moon, and where we are. So there is a line here which talks about Sita's laugh, and there's a comparison again about how ocean's waves are swollen by the moon, which seems to be a hint about how tides are influenced. This is beautiful, wonderful. And I think it would be really nice to discuss with people about this in the original Sanskrit and see how much, what we should, of course, not get carried away. And like I do sometimes, because I feel that he was interested in astronomy, try to think, see that was astronomy entering in everything that he's saying. I mean, not everything, obviously, but at least in some context when it comes. So without getting carried away, it would be very good to try and see what these references could mean. All right. So a lot of the references which I have listed here are simple, sun, moon, and how they are in the sky and so on. That's not so interesting, so I won't go into those. Okay. And so do you think this is a good place to pause and see if there are other questions?
Yeah, ma'am. There is one question by Professor Amir Pahare.
Yes.
Pahare sir, please ask. You are unmuted.
Okay. Good evening, ma'am. I would like to submit that there is a place called Taregana in Bihar, about 30 kilometers from Patna. So it is known as the Karmasthali of Aryabhatta. So in those days, he predicted that this is the best place on the planet Earth to see the full total solar eclipse. So in July 2009, the NASA and the entire world gathered there to see the total solar eclipse for 4 minutes. So in those good old days, without the help of telescopes or any such devices, the Aryabhatta could point out that place near Bihar, about 19 miles or say 30 kilometers, that this is the best place on planet Earth to see the total solar eclipse. So the science was developed at that time.
Taregana, this location, yes, I do remember, I think even back in 2004, Transit of Venus or so.
Yes.
There was a mention of this location. However, of course, it would. Do we have confirmed references which talk about this? The thing is that our particular location, being for all time best location to observe anything, would only refer in terms of the sky conditions.
Yes, okay. But I do remember that the scientists from across the world landed at Taregana in 2009,
yes,
July.
Yes, but that is because, you know, like if there is an eclipse taking place, the path of the eclipse is narrow. So there are some locations which come within the path of the eclipse. So if let's say Taregana is a location which is in the path of the eclipse, so naturally
Yes, ma'am. The Taregana is a short form of Tare Ganana, means counting of stars. So the abbreviation later on became Taregana. It was originally Taregana, means counting of stars.
Yes, I remember this. There was this group space which was using this location, and they were telling that this is the local lore that Taregana refers to Tareginna. And
yes.
So this is lore as of now. And if we can also try and find references which mention this, that would be a very, very, very useful thing. And yes,
ma'am, you can explore that this is called as the Karmasthali of Aryabhatta as well.
Yes, yes. So the thing is that once again about the location where Aryabhatta was located, there is still again some little bit of speculation. Some people also refer to Kerala as the possible location.
Yes.
But this is again one kind of direction one should go and try to find more rigorous references which give all of this information.
Yes.
So yes,
much.
Yes. And but continuing with what you were saying, that the fact that maybe a particular location is demarcated as a location from where you observe, one possibility is if it is a little at a height so that the surrounding obstructions are not seen. Back in those days, light pollution may not have been so much of an issue. So only that visibility, horizon visibility should be good. So it is quite possible that a location like this this location may have been set aside as an observing point, and maybe there was even some construction. They could be simple stone constructions which give some idea about positions. Like, you know, there are some of these Chausat Yogini temples in the country. They have a kind of a circular construction open to the sky. And they can actually be used for quantitative measurement of positions in the sky. So they may have been, I mean, I'm not saying that they were used that way, but any such construction could have been used. So it is possible that this location, and again, Aryabhatta also did have in his text a separate chapter on how instrumental observations are to be done. So there's a possibility that there were some instruments also, stone kind of instruments which are constructed and kept here, and therefore the location became more useful for observations.
Because
and
I
so
do
on.
Remember very vividly and very clearly that the entire world media was there to observe the phenomena, and people said, the caption was in the papers, that Taregana got its 4 minutes of stardom or limelight across the world.
Yes, yes. But modern context, we have to also take it that because there is an astronomical phenomenon happening, and it's not just in modern context. Even if we go back to a few hundred years, people used to travel halfway across the globe to observe a particular phenomenon. So the people came to India in 18th century and 19th century when transit of Venus was visible from India, but not from, let's say, Europe or so. So that also happens. And so there are specific locations from where then observations are taken up because they are in the path of an astronomical event. So that also happens. And yeah, so thank you for
thank you, ma'am.
Bringing all of this out. Okay. So are there any other thoughts to share? I am hoping that someone has responded about coming up with help for the text in original.
Ma'am, we have a question from the chat from Uma Maheshwari ji. She's asking,
yes,
astrology and horoscope just a myth? Am I right? She had a question.
Yeah, I would like to say that somewhat, I mean, yes to that, in the sense that they're at least, I mean, they do not have a rigorous science basis. There may even be some mathematics in it because of drawing certain kind of links to positions of objects in the sky to things that happen in the lives of people. But why should that happen? There is no science link to that. So, I mean, I would like to say, I mean, say yes to her question. Okay. And
thank you, ma'am. I don't think so. If there are some questions, ma'am, we will take them on mail and we'll mail those questions to you. And even if somebody wants to join, we'll take that on mail and we'll just let you know. And as you told us that you'd like to extend this talk someday on some other platform, then also that would be a better thing to do also. Thank you, ma'am.
Yes, yes.
Now I invite principal of the college for his comments. Dr. Bhargav, please come forward for your comments.
Thank you, Dr. Kalpana. It was really a great time what we were listening to and the things which we were experiencing. I must say to Dr. Ratna Shree that the things which you have just I will not say that you requested, rather you come forward with the things. I will be very happy if we can have some sort of association we people from Ujjain and your mentorship, if we can have that. So we can carry out a sort of, I will not say research, but we'll try to find out some facts that how Kalidas could come to know all these things. And as you said that if some Sanskrit fellow comes and joins the event, that will make the things better. So as a principal of the college, as a chairperson of the internal quality assurance cell, and as a citizen of Ujjain, I must say that as a citizen of Ujjain, we are ready to take up such a project. If you give us your mentorship to us, if you are ready to mentor us for such kind of venture, we will be very happy to have this on our platform, on the platform of Mother Science College, because not only that this will be something different, this is what I feel is our responsibility also, because Kalidas is not a poet of India only, he's a poet of the whole world. He is simply the greatest of all poets of all times. So it will be really very nice to see if we can find out some scientific drawings from his works, and it will really be very nice to see, as one of the participant was asking, that can one identify Mars through naked eye? But the thing which you later on told, that he was comparing smile of Sita with the oceanic waves. So this is really, really very enlightening to all of us, that this shows that Kalidas must have been to a place where he must be there at some seaside. So it will really be very nice to see that how was his life, when did he, and where did he go to see all these things, and who taught him, like who enlightened him that this is Mars, this is movement, prograde and degrade movements and retrograde movements and all kind of these kind of things. So I really wanted to put the request that you please be with us to do such, because we have a Sanskrit university here in Ujjain. So I will request those people to join us or to come forward with a project or a proposal where we can carry out such research or some kind of thing which can really be very new for Ujjain, for the history of Ujjain. We can bring something which is still unexplored. So the Madhav Science College and its team, the whole team, will be really doing something for Ujjain. That is what we can contribute for this holy place. So I request you to be with us for all the times, as you have said that you want to. You will be very happy if you can join us on some other platforms. So we'll be requesting you to be with us. You become a part of our mentors club, where you can guide us, you can enlighten us, you can help us in doing certain things. So we can have, as the new education policy tells also, that we can shift from one course to other, from one idea to other. We can get credit for that. So if some student come across, and if he is not from our college, if he comes from some other place, from some other university, we will be very happy to host this kind of thing, this kind of project. And our college will be definitely obliged by you if you accept our proposal. So I thank you, and this was really a wonderful talk. I was there to listen all these things, your studies about Raghuvansham, Shakuntalam, and Abhigyan Shakuntalam, and Malvika Agnimitram. And it was really very nice. You have studied more than what we Ujjaini people have studied. So we get a chance to listen everything from the Kalidas through Kalidas Mahotsav. And probably some of us do go there, but this kind of thing, that the scientific temperament of Kalidas, or the scientific issues which he handles in his literature, we'll be very happy if we can organize a webinar. Not exactly webinar, the new normal will come definitely, and we'll be meeting very soon. That is what we can hope today. So we'll be organizing this kind of thing in our college. And if you can be with us, if you may be with us on those days, we'll be organizing that only when you are with us, when you will be with us. So I thank you once again for being with us and giving this wonderful thing. Not only because you have informed us what is there in Kalidas's literature, rather for taking us to a place where we must think out of boundaries and out of box, and we must do something. And we can really contribute not only to the education system, but to a place which is next to heaven, called Ujjain. Thank you, Rashmi.
Thank you very much, sir. Thank you for your nice deliberation. Now I would officially like to thank Dr. N. Ratnashri for being with us. I would like to, on behalf of Internal Quality Assurance Cell, I would like to thank her on behalf of UGC. This program has been organized by under the flagship program Pride of this college, where we are just educating our students not about the different scientific parameters, but being a science college, it is our responsibility to teach them about the new policies which are there, and we want to teach them about the new policies from a draft to execution, when the policy is drafted, when something is thought about a policy, where we want to start from there. So this was this Eduthon 2020 is just a initiative to about all these things. And yes, madam, today actually what we are thinking, that has been come true. It was a truth. Whatever we are thinking about you have taken us from, not from present to future. The title of this Eduthon was from present to future, but you have taken us from past to present to future, where you have integrated all the three axes of Kal, which we can say, that is Bhut, Bhavishya, Bhut, Vartaman or Bhavishya. Aapne un teeno ko aaj integrate karkar humko sikhaya ki kis prakar se aage badha ja sakta hai. Thank you very much for being with us. I thank principal of the college, Dr. Arpan Bhardwaj, for giving us insight and for giving us the opportunity to do, and for giving us the strength to organize such programs. I once again thank State Project Directorate, Department of Higher Education Quality Improvement Project, SPD, DHE Bhopal, for giving us opportunity to bring out programs of academic excellence. I thank all the participants who are with us. I once again thank Minister of Higher Education, Minister, Department of Higher Education, Government of Madhya Pradesh, Dr. Mohan G. Yadav, for all his best wishes, which he showers on for all this type of academic programs. And I would just want to remind, I would just want to tell madam that this type of topics are very near to the heart of our higher education minister. He always talks about integration of such types of things. So thank madam for bringing a real, what I can say, vision into all these things. And I thank participants. I thank all and everybody who was with us. Thank you once again. And here we are signing off. Thank you once again. There is an information for participants. Our guests can leave now. Thank you very much for being with us. Participants, we are just, principal sir, we want
tomorrow's event. Please yeah, make an announcement of tomorrow's event.
Yes, sir. Tomorrow we are having the third day of this Eduthon and 2020. And tomorrow we'll be having a lecture by Padmashri Dr. Alok G. Mehta. And he will also be talking about the broader perspective of higher education, the new educational policy and higher education. So please be with us. He's a journalist, you all know that. So he'll be there with us right at this time, that is 3 p.m. So ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, please be with us tomorrow at this time, 3 p.m. Thank you very much. We have posted this feedback link. Please fill this feedback link by 8 p.m. Submit it and you will get your certificates. Please do not ask for feedback links on WhatsApp and for on mail. However, you can ask your questions. You can write to us on our email ID, which you know that. MadhavScienceCollege@gmail.com. We have already provided you. You can write your questions on that email ID. But please do not ask for feedback form on that ID. Thank you very much. This feedback link is also posted on YouTube. You can just click here on this Zoom, or you can click at the YouTube and you can just fill up the feedback form. Thank you very much for being with us. Thank you once again.